Guys, let's get started. So guys, the recording is coming through, a couple of caveats to it. There is a bit of static in it. I'll try to clean it up, but for now, I'll post the video in the raw. Also guys, do not share this video with your friends. Right? Because, yeah, we're having a lot of frank conversations. Sometimes you make statements about companies or companies or whatever. So that, right? One single lawsuit in this place to shut down. We can't afford to have that. So please don't share this video, otherwise I won't be able to make this recordings available to you. These are not meant to be public. And also, the conversations that are public, they lack interpersonal, you know, that interaction, that close interaction you should have with people. And the informality you lose, then you can become a very formal person, which has no intention. So you can preserve our atmosphere and still be safe, only if you don't share it. Okay guys, with that, let's get started. Let us summarize. What did we summarize? You can have interpretability is very tightly linked to feature importance of one or the other. They're related. So we're dealing with it again today as one topic, even though there are differences between the two, we're treating it as one topic. Now, one approach is, of course, your linear model will take you there. If linear model takes you there, feature importances are essentially your coefficients on scale data, isn't it? For linear logistic and so forth, if you have a linear model. But in more general, at any given point, the importance of a feature is the rate of change. How much the response will change if you change that feature a little bit. That is literally the concept of feature importance at that particular point. And the other thing we realize is that feature importance is a local phenomenon. Okay? It has very different values, a ranking of features, based on where you are in the feature space. We took the example of the sale of ice cream. When your proximity to the beach is already pretty high, proximity is not likely to be the most important feature. You might as well go improve the quality of the ice cream. If the quality of the ice cream is pretty high, if you're far from the beach, you're far better coming closer to the beach. You'll get more substantive gain in your sales through that. So features, how much the features matter depends upon where you are. So global feature importances are achieved by doing some sort of aggregation, some interesting things, if we'll talk about that. And the concept of feature importance, as I said, is greatly tied to the grade, locally, it is the grade. But the main problem that we face when I left you guys with the question is, you are saying there's a black box. Given input, it will make a prediction. Okay? The machine has learned what is essentially a black box. Okay? It's not anything. What the function is in any analytical form. If you ask a neural network, you can say, you know, these are all my weights. So many layers, so many weights. This is the net weight of it together. A weight tensor. Then you say, well, how does that help you? Right? You can't use that to explain to a basis on what has really happened. Or which features matter there. It's complicated, it's very complicated. Especially deep neural networks, with many, many layers, interpretability is a challenge. And yet we do need interpretability. So the question therefore becomes, if F is implicit and not available to us, how can we still get a gradient of F at a given point? That was a challenge. So what do you think, guys, what should we do? Particular point, just do. What you could do is, and you got it very well, you do perturbation of each of the variables. Yeah? You change the variables locally at that particular point. Let us say that at a given point, x0, You want to know how, what is the ranking of features? How important are the features? How much do they matter? What you're asking for is essentially grad of F evaluated at X. You are asking for the partial derivative with respect to each of the features. So the question comes, well, how are you going to obtain that? Data, you can just dip into the data and see, given X naught, are there neighboring points? Right? And if I go to a point in which the first factor, X1 has changed, X2 has changed, if you're lucky, you might find neighboring data very close by data, which has this perturbation with respect to one variable. You're unlikely to get that, isn't it? But that shouldn't stop you. What you can do is, you can deliberately create, so suppose this is X naught. What can you do? You can create small perturbations of this, small changes in this. You can do plus minus delta. Create new values by doing perturbation. Are you understanding that? Create new values. Those become your new points in the feature space. So you are saying, this point in the feature space, X naught, let me just create more points around it. We are literally creating new points. Because we are creating new points, we are saying, let me see what is this model trying to tell me. It's some function. Okay? And so by doing this, now I can tell the small changes in each of the features, how much does it do. Or more specifically, there is a way I can put it. See, locally, however complicated the F surface is, the manifold of F is, right? The function is the surface in this feature space. With the response variable also in there. A bit generalized. It's a surface, right? It's a hypersurface. However complicated the hypersurface is, for example, if you look at that was, however wrinkled up it is or convoluted it is, locally to a point, so long as you stay local, locally what does it appear? It appears plain, it appears like a hyperplane, right? It appears safe. If I take this globe, no matter where I am, it looks flat. Locally, every surface is flat. Now, we always make the assumption in these situations that you are in a continuous and differentiable surface. Roughly speaking, you are in a manifold. Right? There's a concept of manifold. You have a manifold, smooth manifold. Given a smooth manifold, any locally point will look like a plane. If it looks like a plane, what can I do? The relationships, if they are planar, I can fit a linear model, isn't it? That will work only in the neighborhood of that point. Does that make sense? So in the neighborhood, see, the way we argue this, we can say we don't know the function globally. It's too complicated to be explicitly stated. But nonetheless, I can put in perturbations, x naught plus all sorts of perturbations of x. Right? Different values of r, different perturbations, just change this a little bit, that a little bit. Pick a lot of points in the neighborhood of x. Right? You get a whole lot, now that is your new data set. You have a new data set which is made up of x naught plus, look, this is your data set, right? And each of these data sets produces its own yi hat. Your model will produce a yi hat. Make sense? This is there. This relationship holds. Now you hypothesize that there is a linear relationship there because it has to be. Locally it will be a plane, a tangent plane. Right? So given the tangent plane, at x naught, model it as so what did we do? We can now model it as a linear model. Once we do the linear model, then we can find, what can we find? We can quite literally find the coefficients of each, isn't it? And we have to change all these things. That is one approach. Another approach that people take, and see, another way is that all you have to do is do small perturbations. Right? Small perturbations of F. delta f delta x I will give you, this will be approximately equal to, all you have to do is small perturbations. See how much the function changes with respect to each of the feature with small changes, right? And just average them locally. You will get a pretty good sense of the partial derivative. Am I making sense? And those partial derivatives essentially give you a sense of feature importance. That's exactly what it is. Go ahead. No, you can't mix it. Think about it. Part is between correlation between two features. So, histogram is just the distribution of one feature. No, here's the target for you. If you look at the correlation of the one feature, x1 to a target, you get a global relationship. Right? You get a much more global relationship. So look at the river. What was the correlation of x1 and x2 against the y variable and the river variable? Very little correlation, isn't it? And that correlation told you no idea about the decision surface, isn't it? Because it's a unit. It's a very local structure to know the river surface.
How
does
the
small change is small. Like if your data is already, let's say, scaled, normalized on a scale of so its perturbations are like, you know, 0.001, 0.002. It's not perturbations, it's 0.001. And you look at the local market. Yeah. No, you're not doing that. See, what you're doing is, you're creating, see, think about it this way. In the listening to a thing, you're creating a lot of points. So what we do is, suppose, I'll give you an example. Let's say that x naught is equal to, I'll take some value, 12, 5, 6, 9, 11.
Yeah.
This is a five-dimensional point. Are we doing that? So what it means is I can create x naught plus delta 1 is equal to, on 12, just do a random perturbation.
9,
11, 13. Not that big. Not that big. Yeah. Let's say that 12.5, 4.9, I'm just taking some examples, 5.1, or even that is big, 5.7 let's say, 8.8, 11.2, I did some random change. Now, hang on guys, before you continue, the delta 2 is equal to, again I can create some points, x naught plus delta 3, again I do random perturbations, are we together? So what am I doing? I'm making very small changes. I'm looking at the neighborhood of that point.
So that point is five dimensional.
Five dimensional, and including the target variable, it will be 6 dimensional.
Right. Okay.
Exactly. And so what will happen? So what will happen is that your y hat can be is now some other linear function of x near x naught, isn't it? And not only that, I can at each of these points tell that what is the change. So I can evaluate the function. I can put x naught plus delta 1 through the black box. Come up with y 1 hat. Right?
Yeah.
Likewise, I can do for the rest of it. So let me make it I can find all of these points. All of these points, therefore, I can ask myself, what is delta yi over delta I itself? Okay. This will be the gradient in that direction, particularly. But getting all of this, all I need to do is find a plane that I have here. Am I making sense? Solid will call up here. So let me put it this way. Feature space, right? It's by convention. You know. See, you always think of it like that. Feature x1, feature x2, this is what. Right? So now, your relationship is a surface. There is some surface, right? Any function f of y is some function of x1, x2, you can tell it's your surface, it's describing a surface in three dimensions. So now when you go to fourth dimension, you know that now x1, x2, x3 is actually a volume. You don't call it a volume. You still call it a feature, hypersurface, the hyperplane. And y is still sticking up. So you say your floor has three dimensions. Right? Or your floor has four dimensions or five dimensions. So if you have a five dimensional floor and you have this y, so your neighborhood is actually a hyperplane. But a hyper, the full relationship is some hypersurface. It's hard to visualize because in reality it's not. It's a volume, like already feature space, neighborhood is a volume. Okay? But you don't think of it as a volume. You think as though it's a disk, five dimensional disk. Are we together? You think you have created perturbations on a five dimensional disk? So the best way to think, the way mathematicians think about it is, they always visualize in two. That's why I always tell you, keep your intuition to two. But when you're talking about five dimension, you should always say, of course, as you can see, it's a... I'm joking. Go ahead.
So how would all these gradients being on the same surface, the flat surface, how would they all average out to have the gradient of the entire?
No. I am saying, guys, very simple. Let's pay attention to it. Let me make it very obvious. This is the tip of India. At this particular moment, I can, at this tip of India, if I do a local thing, I'll get a plane. What will be the plane? It will be going like this. This is my local model here. Whereas if I'm going now to the United States, and especially to, let's say, somewhere in Alaska, my plane is not going like this. They're completely different models. You see that? That's a, so locally, hold on, locally everywhere there is a model, a linear model. Does that make sense? Now, and locally you have gradients, you can compute, and therefore locally you have a concept of feature impactness. Small perturbations. On that, I created neighboring points. But given the neighboring points, I can describe a plane. The only purpose of creating neighboring points is to do what? Create a plane. Given the plane, I can write the equation of that plane, y hat locally at x naught, is some function g, right? G of x in the neighborhood of x naught, in the neighborhood of x naught, where g of x is some beta naught plus beta 1 x1 plus beta 2 x2 plus beta 3 x3, because that's the equation of a plane. What are each of these coefficients? Those are the, if I do gradient of g, it will literally be these things, like beta 1, beta p locally, and these are essentially your feature impotences, isn't it? Are we following the reason that is the reason. Simple argument. Okay. Now, this is one way people do it. The second way people do is they say locally, instead of a linear model, people say, I know what a decision tree is. Right? I can represent this with a decision tree, locally. Right? So sometimes people will use a decision tree because they like decision trees. You can do that. Some people find decision trees more interpretable. Like in the neighborhood of this, value is this, then this is it. And in a decision tree, you have feature importance. How do you have feature importance? The feature along which you split first is the most important feature. The feature along which you split the next is the next important feature, isn't it? So you have feature importance from a decision tree. Personally, I prefer linear models. It has a nice interpretability to it. If you go with the assumption that locally, it is a linear surface, you can do linear model. You can do another thing. So you just perturb it. Now you realize that this is model agnostic. It doesn't care what model you have. You can always make locally linear models, isn't it? Because you're treating the model as a black box. You don't care whether it's a random forest, support vector machines, neural networks, right? Whatever it is, gradient boosting, fat boosting, whatever. Pick your favorite algorithm. It is invariant of this argument. It goes down to the underlying mathematics. If you do believe there is a relationship F, locally it has to look linear. And therefore, feature importance is a local phenomena, of course. And off that hyperplane, these are feature importances are just the gradients of the hyperplane. The slope tells you what matters next. Locally. Right. Very good. Very good question. So his question is exactly the, okay, let me ask this question. See, in Alaska, it goes like this. In India, it goes like this. Right. So you realize that they don't agree with each other, right? So what happens if I start bringing these two points together? What happens is, as you bring them closer and closer together, you will realize that they will actually, the model that is here, will represent, I mean, in other words, it's called a property of the manifold. It's a fundamental property of smooth manifolds. That the intersection region between, suppose I take neighboring regions and I create local planes, those two planes in the intersecting region have to make the same prediction. Means it has to represent both of these. It's like, if you're very close, these two planes cannot be like this. They have to be almost the same.
You don't
have to. Yes, it is a fundamental. People use the word that you have an atlas. You see, these are local colors, local maps. And as you join the maps together, you get an atlas, which has to be consistent. Okay. So I'll give you a very real view. So imagine that you're looking at the wind velocity in a very complicated topography. There are hills and valleys and whatnot. And there is a wind rolling by. It went. Possible. You realize that at each point there is a wind velocity vector. There's a speed of the wind and there's a direction to the wind. Common sense says that at these two points, they may be different. You know? Because of the hill, the wind may be going up like that. Because of this, it may be coming down like this. It may be turning around or something. But as you come to an overlapping region, these local models have to say the same thing. Isn't it? Both these neighboring models, they have to essentially say the same thing. Does that make sense? That's a meaning. So, you have that. Now, here's a third thing people, so this is one way, make local models, which to me looks to be the gold standard. Make linear models, make decision trees, equivalent and give your interpretation. The other thing people do, which is interesting, is they ask this question, see, I cannot visualize even this hyperplane there. I cannot visualize this relationship. So suppose the sale of the ice cream depends on many factors. It depends on quality of ice cream, it depends on proximity to the beach, it depends on the amount of advertising dollars you have spent, brand name recognition, and many, many factors. But at a given point, at a given value, let's say that we have to make local decisions. You have to say, my sale currently is this, my proximity is this, my quality is this, and I need to just see, get a sense of visualize, or, you know, part of interpretability is to be able to visualize the relationship of sales to these factors. Now you say, well, you know, you are two factors, you can't visualize, can you? Sale is the y-axis, the z-axis, the up-axis. Then you're left with only two axes here. Right? So you pick your thing. So you say, okay, I'll take say, the proximity to the beach, and the second factor I'll take quality. But there is a problem. Your model now has other factors. And you realize that there's a problem to that. Those other factors different values of the other factor represent different regions of the feature space. Isn't it? You see that? Suppose the third axis is, what did I say? The amount of advertising, dollars that you spend. That's the third axis. So based on how much advertising dollars you spend, assuming advertising helps the sale of ice cream, these importances may change. Right? The surface may look differently. But how do you visualize? So one thing that people do is they make the so-called partial dependency graphs. Right? They marginalize the third axis, the advertising. So what they will do is they just take random values of advertising, right? And feed it through the model. So they will take a lot of points around x naught. Suppose there are three factors, x1, x2, x3. This being the proximity to the beach, this being the quality, there's a problem. I can't visualize why in the three, I need to throw it. So what you do is you take random values of this, lots of random values of this, right? And you compute the values of this, these two, and you find why. And you just visualize it. Right? It gives you some rough sense. Are we together? The idea being that if this doesn't matter so much, I mean, it just matters, but in a smooth surface, think of a bell curve. If you take a bell curve and you take a section of a bell curve, in the proximity of a point, if you change the z value a little bit, ultimately, it will, I mean, one axis, let's say that a two-dimensional bell curve is x, y, and the up is the probability. You take a section of a bell curve, what do you get? A bell curve. In the proximity of a point, you can say that I don't want to care about x, the y. So what you can do, whatever value of y is there, just take random values around there. Compute your probability with respect to x. And you say, well, okay, let's average over it and show. Because it will make sense, isn't it? You will get the correct relationship. You know, you will get the correct relationship in the neighborhood of that point. Don't go too far. Isn't it? So in the neighborhood of that point, we can do that. So then you will get a dependency plot near that point, showing the relationships. Yeah. Because 2x2 plots, you can make those beautiful 3D, they look like beautiful 3D plots. That goes towards interpretability. Those are all locally interpretable models. Now, let's generalize beyond that. What people do sometimes is they say, well, we don't just want local interpretable models, we want feature importance globally. You realize that that will be averaging over all the situations, if you agree. So for visualization, since we talked about visualizations, what they will do is, they will take all values of x1, x2, and the sale of ice cream, but now the advertising dollar is problematic. They take random values all across the spectrum. Right? And they'll average over it, they don't care. So they will make a more global model out of it. The moment you do that, what is the fear? It may not be representative, isn't it? The moment you go globally, in marginalizing a particular predictor, a particular axis, you sort of are making a good faith assumption. You're using optics, but learning a little bit. That is one aspect. The other thing is, how do you do global feature importances? What can you do? You could do one of these things. Randomly go take lots of points, sufficiently many points to cover up the feature space. Everywhere find the feature importances and take the average of all of them. You can do that. Okay. So that is another way of doing it. X1, X2, you keep it. That's the first point. But now you have to put a value here. Just put some random value here. And then compute the Y. Compute the Y coming out of the model. The Y. You can do that, right? The moment I have three values, I will compute one.
The random values,
sorry.
That is the combination of
the perturbation. It's just a small perturbation. So you can do that. Whatever the value is, So what you do is you take some random value, any values here. Now you build a model only in terms of y is some function g not of x1, x2 based on these x1, x2. You already have the y. You try to build a new model. What is this model then? It is not even aware of x2. What will this function look like? It will look like some surface, right? What is yes. Okay, means that we don't take it locally, we take all values of x, see all values of x. Oh boy. See, to build a model, how did you get the y? You need the y, right? How did you get the y? Yeah, you have to use the value of x, random values of x. No, you don't perturb x1, x2. You take a lot of values of x3 here.
Let's say, two different cases. One case is with deltas across them.
See guys, okay.
The other one is axis which is marginalized with random values.
Just take, see, you take your legitimate x1, x2. Even that, you take x1, x2, x3. You take lots of values. You'll get a y. That is phase one. We have x1, x2, x3, feed it into your black box, you get a one. That part is easy. Okay. Now what do you do? And now, just be careful. You can choose to keep the x1, x2 as what was in the data. X3 you can take from the data or you can do what you want. But generally, now what happens is you have y's. Because you have y, what can you do now? You can now go and build another model which is a function only of x1, x2. And that you can visualize. Because what will that show? That will show the how the same respond basically to proximity and quality only. Now suppose I want to do proximity and advertising, then quality I'll just randomize another thing. So you get this, how many plots will you get? You'll get three plots. Proximity and quality. Proximity and advertising and quality, three different terms. But by looking at how the same does, visually looking at it, you get some interpretability, some that visualization helps you. Isn't it? So you can apply that technique to many things. Suppose you have 10 variables. You can still do two at a time. 10C2, you'll have a whole lot of jobs which you can do 10C2. Now these models obviously are far more accurate when you're local. Isn't it? Close to a point, suppose I'm given x1, x2, x3. Close to x1, x2, x3, just by doing small perturbations of these, I can build a surface. But by not going too far, I can make a model here and see how does it vary locally. Or that will be pretty accurate. Or on the other hand, I can do a more global thing, you know, all values of x1, x2, x3, I can randomly pick. This is random picking of values. And hitting it through the black box and coming up with a bar. And including x3 altogether and saying, okay, let me plot the surface, x1, x2, y. I can plot the surface.
So basically, perturbation in case of three variables,
you perturbing
the third variable.
Perturbing the third variable? Random. Yeah. Or you can even take it. You don't have to just filter it. You can just perturb all of them locally to just see the surface. Just to make a plot, a three-dimensional plot, save the file stream. Proximity and quality. What can I do? I can choose a certain point, quality base value, actually. And around that value, I can randomly pick lots of points. Right? See, if I stay very close, I'll define a plane. If I take a slightly bigger surface, then it may be more complicated. The bigger the surface I take, the more complicated it becomes. But I can draw the surface of two variables at a time against them. Right? So those are called partial dependency curves. That is it. I mean, see, these are all means to somehow interpret or visualize high-dimensional data or high-dimensional relations. You can do that. Right? So So that is the next apple. Go ahead, Kobe.
This kind of partial derivative is
going to say that visualizing partial derivative. Sort of local effects around it. And when you visualize, you see, it locally it will be flat. But as you move away, now hills and valleys will begin to show. Is it? So it becomes beautiful actually. When you plot it out 2x2, and I highly encourage you to do that, any one of your data sets, make these 2x2 plots. And it's very nice, it looks beautiful. It gives you a lot of intuition into what is going on. See, ultimately, it just helps you interpret what's going on. Not the third variable, just 1 and 2 are not important. Isn't it? Suppose it's flat, completely flat. Then these two variables do matter. In that neighborhood. So, one second. See, for example, at the base of this, the height doesn't change with respect to either this axis or this axis. So, locally, neither of the two directions matter. So which is the intuition that in a valley it's given. So randomly, this random gossip random. NP one, random one. But which is just labeling values. The word is, maybe I shouldn't have used the book for it. Shake it up. Work with scaling. Always work with scale. The basic rule guys, whenever you do machine learning, always work with scale data. Okay. Are you together guys? So far so good?
Let's use
the word shake it.
Yeah, shake it up is a good word. What if like when I get that it is going to be a break? Very
good.
Very good. Very good. So that really define that kind of
it's very small. Mm-hmm. Like, 0.001 and 0.001.
This kind of point, if you consider it's not realistic, that's where I.
But see, if your data is standardized, you realize that each of the predictors is varying from minus 2 to 3. Predominantly.
Yeah, so that kind of a
six is a value, six is the range of the data. So with respect to six, you can imagine that 100th or 1,000. These are all small perturbations.
Does it have to be seen in relation to the changes seen in the Y?
Yes, of course. You feed it to get the Y.
Yeah, and Y hat is not changing, it changes still for the different.
Yeah. So the whole idea is that, see, the surface, so think about this. This surface. Ultimately, right, this is it. In a two-dimensional world, two predictable, Y, this is that. This is literally your function. Now this function may be pretty flat. Well, I'm not really going to get flat, but we try it. It may be pretty flat. Looks like a hyperplane, isn't it? Or it could be like, okay. This is looks like a complicated relationship. But kind of complicated relationship, you realize that locally there are tangent points. So you can make local models and local people. Yes. So basically what I'm saying is that it is probably not as accurate to talk about global features. Can you come to that concept? It is a far more precise term, local.
Right?
No, it depends upon where you want to make prediction. So for example, the way the question comes in the domain is, you just predicted that this guy's ice cream sale will depend a lot on quality. Why? Because this is how much this quality currently is and proximity to the beach currently is. So given the ground truth of where this fellow is, you are predicting, you are telling him that focus on quality. Are you together? This is how it becomes. Then, a more aggregate or average of value is globally, what are the feature impacts? So they are all based upon, as you can imagine, hold on, let me finish this one. It is based upon the averaging of all of this, isn't it? You average all of this, you take aggregate somehow, and you get global feature impacts. There is another technique that people use. What they do is something quite interesting. They will do this. They will say, this is a black box. Right? I will feed it a lot of points into the black box, right? And get the prediction. And what I will do is, of that prediction now, I will fit a simpler model like a decision tree on top of it. I think they're arguing that people have it. There is a tree map or something like that. So what they're saying is, you have an algorithm that perfectly fits the data, that makes very accurate predictions. That is good to make predictions. You build another model, this is something funny. You build another model by taking some input points, letting that fancy algorithm make its prediction. Now you get a new data set. On that data set, you try to fit a simpler model, a decision tree typically. Right? And then you look at the feature importance of the decision tree. Right? And you treat the decision tree as the more interpretable approximation to that deeper model. Your question?
Yeah, the question
was the... Let's take it off. Let's take it. Yes, of course. No, what these people do, because now we're talking globally. What they do is they feed a lot of points. They feed, see, as I said, locally, right, we can always fit a linear model of a decision. So that is fine. Now, let's keep the local level. We're talking global. How can we go global? The very simple way is just go average over the feature importances here, there, everywhere. Take averages. The second way that you can do it is, you can say, hey, wait a minute, this is a very fancy model, right? And it represents a decision surface that is, let's say, like this. Okay. Look at this, very complicated surface. It's a classification decision surface, a regression. This is the surface. You say, hey, you know what, it's doable. Let us take some points, right? And look at the prediction, and then say, to this, let us fit a decision tree. Right? Or a simpler model, not necessarily a decision tree, maybe a linear or polynomial model, or some lower degree, more interpretable model. And then when you do that, it turns out that it begins to look approximately like this, I deliberately put it like this. So suppose this is your surface. You see, this surface is very complicated. But we agree that this is a pretty good approximation to it, isn't it? And so what we are essentially saying is that let this be the more accurate surface for predictions, and let this be the interpretational approximation to it. We will use this to explain, this to predict. Does that make sense, guys? And now this simpler surface, you build out of whatever you like, again, your decision tree, your linear models, and so on and so forth. Do that and build this. And again, you never say it, that we will use this complicated surface. You start with a caveat, this is an approximation. But this at least interprets that model. Would you say, right, instead of having no interpretation in a black box for this description, you would rather have, you would still consider it a win to have this.
This is that, bold. This is not
bold.
A cylinder.
Yes. Not a sphere. Bold. Yes, exactly. So you get an overall structure with an approximation. So that is the other approach that you use. And now let me mention the last approach, please.
So from a technique perspective, this is a tool we are learning.
Yes.
The way I'm doing it is like you build the CNN, a neural network, and that you're typing.
Interpret, yes. You just go ahead and make the most accurate model. Yeah. And now you ask that. It makes good predictions. But what is it? I need to interpret. Okay, guys, give me one moment. I'll just check on your launch. Alright guys, please don't disappear, come back. Otherwise we'll miss on to the king of it all. I'm going to talk about shaping. Just find feature importances at lots of points and take the average. Which is by the way if you run in choices. The other thing you do is I said take a very precise model like this, which is a very high fidelity model, captures all the wrinkles and complications of the relationship. But model it with something simpler. And use this for prediction, use this for interpretation. This also has risk, because what happens is that there may be inherent micro-biases or problems sitting in there in the wrinkle that your interpretable model won't speak of. So you're interpreting it one way, but you're predicting another way. So there is a risk to it, but at least you get something, as opposed to just saying, I have a black box. All right, guys. So, Ali. You take random set of points in the feature space.
Right, but you could
compare
like multiple simpler models.
Oh, yes.
And then you just go with the bias
variance
fit up.
That's the best model. Okay, guys. So now I'll tell you about something really interesting. It turns out that this question is there's really a very remarkable way of doing this. That was asked by a person who, when you answered it, the answer was considered so valuable, he was immediately given a Nobel Prize. He did it in economics. So, and there's a remarkable photo that you'll find in your notes. You remember John Nash, a beautiful mind, a very beautiful mind. So there's a picture of this great man, shaping with John Nash. He's a guy of that caliber, very good. Great. And so he said, he posed a problem like this in a game theory. Suppose you have a cricket match. And let's say, as should always happen, India won. Right?
Not with the US.
Not with the US. With England, of course. Okay. So now the question is, different players, suppose they come and say, hey, we should be compensated. Let's say that there is a jackpot. let's say $10 million. Okay? And you have to divide it amongst your peers. Well, each, one easy way is that the 11, so let's say the $11 million. So one easy way is to give each player $1 million. Usually that is not conducive to happiness. Why is that? That's right. So what happens is, I suppose this was one of the arguments that people said about communism and the trouble. The thing is, you cannot make reward invariant of performance. Because the moment you make rewards invariant of performance, performance will set. People will not work hard. In socialist countries, we have seen this from experience. So the right way, I suppose, would be to give each person based on the value they brought to the table. But then the question comes, how do you derive value? One guy would say, gosh, I worked so hard, I was the wicked keeper. Another would say, well, I was the bowler. Right? Another would say, I was the batsman, I was a great fieldsman. This and that. So you can have different people clamoring and claiming different value. So this is a very fundamental fact in economics. The economic issue is the equitable distribution of wealth, given rewards, given a situation like this, how would you do that? So this is like giving, assigning. In a cooperative game, because this team collaborated, they didn't fight with each other, they collaborated. And the end result of collaboration is a victory, trophy. Now, what is the contribution of each of them to that game? To map it to machine learning, here is a model that made this prediction, which is pretty accurate. This model is pretty successful at making good predictions. Right? Now, it is a conspiracy of many features, not a conspiracy, collaboration between many features that made and that went into the model that were part of the ingredients of the model. There is the algorithmic part, but there is also the features itself. And so you can ask for the features, how much did each feature contribute to those predictions? Which is essentially saying how important was this feature overall. Do you see the relationship between the game theoretic problem and machine learning? So to answer this, what Shapley suggested is something very simple. You take every situation imaginable in which the player is and is not. Right? And you look at their difference. So imagine a world in which you keep on playing the same match against England over and over and over again. And you create all sorts of teams with different players. In some teams, Nachiket is there. In other teams, Nachiket is not there. But the other composition of the teams are also changing. So you make every possible combination of 11 people in the room. So we have 30 people. Imagine every possible 11 people team. And pitch it against it. And see what happens, what is the outcome, how much you win, and so on and so forth, the degree of the outcome. And now what can you do? You get a differential understanding of how much, like what happens when, on average, when Nachiket is there and when Nachiket is not there. Now I can do it for every other player. Right? And what you will notice is that the players who are significantly valuable, the effect of their being absent will be much more dramatic than the effect of small players who are contributing lesser value. Does that make sense, guys? Do you understand the argument here? I will create every possible combination of their team in which Sudhir is there, or Sudhir is there, or not there. And then, relative, by looking at the marginal, the differential effect of their presence versus absence, I have a sense of how much value they bring to the table. Right? That one statement was working really nice, actually. Its problem is, obviously, that, see, and if you think about it in a global way, that is the only real way you can deal with gender bias from a global perspective. No, no, see, we have 30 people in the room. So, assume we have that.
But such a model of taking out by one person and owning the scenario would still be driven by the characteristics of that person which is taken out.
Yeah, so what we are saying is that there may not be too many goalkeepers or wicketkeepers, for example. Okay? So therefore what happens is, suppose there are 6 wicketkeepers. So they can only be wicketkeepers with different 6 people. Okay? In any given team, you have to pick 1 of 6 wicketkeepers. But the other players are randomly chosen. There are many, many teams you can form with different variations of other players. So if you really think how many 11 people team I can create out of 30 people, it's actually a combinatorial explosion. It's a huge number of people. But because it's a huge number, law of large number happens. Means differential computations. Like, should I be able to finish that computation on the computer at all? Right? The differential contribution becomes very apparent. Are we together? From a global perspective. So, to do that, is to use the, and that has been implemented. By the way, I used that in 2012, literally, as one of my secrets, I suppose, it came out of the open source community. Okay? I had my own implementation of Shoko for PJ projects. And the reason we had to do that, and a little bit of history, I guess now it is not in the idea. But the question that I was trying to answer way back in 2012 is, suppose attrition happens. I have a very complicated model of employee attrition, which was really complicated. Competitors are the largest application analysis. Yeah, some pretty sophisticated analysis. The whole problem is, the business doesn't care. It cares a little bit that it can predict attrition. But see, the attrition predictions, the accuracies were still in the 70-80%. It depends upon the company or the group that you're analyzing, the comparison, et cetera. Somewhere you are more accurate, somewhere you could even maintain the 5% accuracy. So those are good numbers, by the way, if you look at that. So then, but business is much more concerned about actionable insights. They want to know which factors are important for attrition. So suppose I want to HRMC invest its energy, should they stock the break room with better candies or whatever? Or should they, you know, do something else, or, you know, give more money, whatnot. They would like to know what factors matter so much. You realize that. So you realize how this whole feature importance becomes a very real problem. And the way I solved it, it was actually. But of course now, you guys are very, very lucky. Because Shetty is now an open source writer. So you can get money. So you can do that. So that library is called SHA. Some factors can increase the sale of ice cream, some factors will decrease the sale of ice cream. For example, if it is breezy, likely the sale of ice cream will go down. And how much it affects in either direction. And Shapley packet is very lovely because it tells you across the parameter feature space where all what factors matter common. So it is both global and it has local aspects to it. And that is the last module I will talk to. It is also time, I promise that in 3 hours I'll finish. I have finished in less than 3 hours. Those are the models that you may have got to. So the way I explained it is differently explained in those articles. I tried to simplify and get to the intuition behind it. But tell me after this and the articles if you find an alignment with it. Because it's the first time I'm explaining it this way. So I appreciate the feedback. How close it is to what you're doing to me. So you go and read those 5 articles, and I want all of you to explain it to everybody else at 5 o'clock. 5 articles, 5 o'clock. And the third part 3 of one of the articles is a hands-on. Do that hands-on. It is on the Agile data set. And guys, I hope In conclusion, I hope, you agree that feature importance is really a worthwhile topic to study. Of a model, you should know feature importance. And just the naive way of just taking feature importance from a random choice, etc., is sort of a rough and ready way. You can be more careful, you can do it in a more nice way. Today, you are devoted to learning this. Thank you. Are we together? So please get started, have lunch, but don't go to sleep after that. And have your 5 articles to 5 o'clock. So you have a presentation.